Good morning, everybody. Happy 2 weeks from Easter. Yeah, there. Really? Yeah, happy 2 weeks from Easter. We're 2 weeks away from Easter. I wanted to bring that up because we do a sunrise service here right across the street. So Easter sunrise service, we'll meet here on the deck. I'm pretty sure Patty will have a breakfast set up. So we'll get here about 6:50. As the sun starts cracking over the horizon, we'll shoot across the street, do a service, come back and have, well, we can bring some breakfast snacky stuff, or you can have breakfast here, and then we'll hang out, we'll have a set of live music, or not live music necessarily, but music to have breakfast to, and do our regular 9 o'clock service as well. So I met a lot of new people here today, and I saw a lot of people with new faces. I've been looking for a new face for a long time. I haven't used that one in years because my wife said you're wearing it out. So some of you are new. That's a fresh one. For her, it's every other week she hears it. We have an occasion in the house. Where's, I call them Part and At. Art and Pat, can you wave a hand back there? Art and Pat are celebrating today 51 years of wedded bliss. Shackled bliss. So congratulations, and no homicides. I always think that's miraculous. My wife and I are on our 19th year, I think. Do I have it right? We're working into 19, I think. We don't know. We stopped being able to count weeks ago. Men's breakfast every Monday, 7 a.m. at the Potbelly Deli. I can't get away with not showing up this week because the guy who started it is also a professor at IRSC, so he knows I'm on spring break. So if I don't show up Monday and say I was in class, he'll know I'm lying, and I would never lie. So, Jim, if I don't show up, it's because it's a beautiful day and I'm riding my motorcycle somewhere, but I may just ride it to breakfast. All right. That's the facts, Jack. If you want to come join us for the men's breakfast, come on out, 7 o'clock at the Potbelly Deli. If you don't want to, if you're a woman and you want to join us for breakfast, don't. But if you feel like you want to do a woman's breakfast, let us know and we'll start up a woman's breakfast and you can head that up. So let me know about that. This Wednesday at 7 o'clock, we're not doing a regular class. We're going to do a showing of a Rob Bell movie called The Gods Aren't Angry. And it'd take about an hour and a half for the movie itself. And then I'd like to take maybe 10 minutes afterwards for discussion. If you're interested in doing that, come on out. Bring something to drink with you if you like something other than water. I have some microwave popcorn at the store, but if you want to come out and snack or whatever, make believe it's a movie night. I think we have room for about 45 or 50 people or more if we adjust all the living room furniture around in the thrift store. You can make yourself comfortable. Almost. Don't watch the movies with us like you might watch them at home. We don't want to see any of that. See, Jim, he knows exactly what I'm talking about. All right. Again, I want to take a moment to thank Patty McGee, Archie's owner here. Not only does she put up with us and crowding her deck every Sunday with 300 or 400 people that say, hurry up and feed me in the next hour, but she also, on Mondays, for the next two more weeks, they have bingo here on the deck. What time does that start, Mark? 3 o'clock every Monday. And for the past two Mondays and the next two Mondays, she's taking the funds raised from that and helping us raise money toward our box truck for the thrift store. So if come be in support of that all the time, but mostly in the next couple weeks. And Mark's the DJ bingo caller on that. So if he acts up and says something out of line, tell the pastor so we can stone him. That's what you do in church, you know. You find out who made the mistake. You point him out. Everybody gathers around and you kill him with rocks. That's God's love. So that all said, that's not the God's love that we know, is it? So let's just open up with prayer and get into our service. Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank you for another awesome day. We thank you for another opportunity to live, to worship you, to hear your voice, to be led by your spirit within. God, your love has made such a difference in me and so many others that we come here today to worship you in spirit and in truth. And to worship you and lift up our voices in song. We come here to celebrate you today in Jesus' name. Amen. First one is a featured song featuring our maniac back here. Are you a maniac or a new hamster? Maniac. I keep getting confused. She's a maniac. I should know by her actions. Mary brings these songs down from Maine, and we're going to let her be featured first song.
For the sins of the world. 1 John 2, 1 and 2.
Little reminder of the upcoming Easter weekend. But we know one day in his house is worth a million elsewhere. Thank you.
Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Than a thousand elsewhere. One thing I ask, and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask, and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your spirit's water to my soul. I taste it and I see. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you.
Good news for you.
Soon and very soon, we are going. soon. We are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King.
There'll be
no more crying there, we are going to see the King.
There'll be
no more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah. No more dying there, we are going to see the King.
There will be
no more dying there, we are going to see the King.
No, there'll be
no more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Shall there be any rivers we must cross? Should there be any mountains we must climb? God will supply all the strength that we need.
Particularly nice this morning, Mark. Thank you.
Yay,
no, no.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty. through the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior,
particularly emotional this morning, too, for some reason. Thanks, girls. Good job. Good job. Miss Wendy right here. This is Pastor Bob's wife. A lot of people, she's so much behind the scene, but you know what? She's so much on top of the situation. She handles a lot of things behind the scenes. This is Bob's wife, Wendy, for those who don't know her. And during church, she's usually back there with the kids and giving them some blessings. So Wendy's going to take the kids inside. We're still working on getting our camper back. It's, you know, this is the longest 30 days I've ever seen somebody work on something. 30 days turn into half a year, but it's okay because I'm learning how to be patient. All right. So so this week we're working in the books of Acts still. And it really, I am continually amazed that when you start to understand a grace message of God, that no matter what book we go to in the Bible, it is clear that it is always about the leadership of the Spirit. Always, always, always. Once it's clear to you that, wow, God's really just trying to teach us to listen to his leading Spirit, and then we will be able to do the work of God because God will be leading you to do it. And when we step out of that, I heard Mary in her song, you know, and if you should sin, I want you to understand, and this is part of the deeper teaching we do on Wednesdays, that sin isn't sin because God said that's sin, that hatred is sin, and selfishness is sin, and anxiety is sin. That's not because God said so. The reason he calls it sin is because it's a lifestyle of unbelief that will lead you to death. Sin is a lifestyle or an attitude of unbelief where you're not trusting the leading Spirit of God. So anytime you're doing it outside of the leading Spirit of God, you are walking in unbelief / sin. And I don't say this so you feel guilt. I say it so you feel awareness. So you're aware. I had a conversation and somebody said, hey, I heard you went back to school, and I told them the story about how that all happened. And it's really helped me to be clear in my faith that now at 55 years old, I'm finally am pretty sure of who I am and what I'm really about. I'm not a liar anymore because I won't do it. Because I know that when I've done it in my past, it causes huge consequences. That sounds like a selfish motive, but bigger than that, I know it's not God's will. Because God teaches me his will. He wants me to be standing on what is right and living in a lifestyle that is such a way that other people would say, hey, there's something different there. I actually had somebody ask me to lie for them. And I'm like, do you realize I'm a pastor, number one? Well, yeah, that's why I thought you'd do it. No, no, no. Wow. Sorry. I hope I threw somebody under the bus out there, pastors of the world. I won't lie for me. Don't ever expect me to lie for you. I won't do it. And I tried to help him to understand, if somebody will lie for you, they will lie to you. So where is the trust in a relationship? Where is the building of a relationship in that? Sometimes I have to say things that are very hurtful because they're true and necessary to be said, but I say it, I make sure, or at least try to make sure that I'm coming out of a place of love to help you to grow through what I see is going on in your life. And it's a difficult thing to do, but it's something I learned in a leadership training that I've used with me a lot. And sometimes you might hear me say, if we sit down in a conversation where you feel like you want some counsel, are you willing to be teachable? And if you are willing to be teachable, is it okay if I stab you in the front? Because it's going to hurt to hear the truth sometimes. But I care enough about you to tell you the truth, to stab you in the front, so that maybe you'll learn from this experience. And it's difficult sometimes. And your flesh may be wounded, but your spirit may be sharpened. And that's my intent, is for your best good, not for mine. I can't say I do it all the time. I got to be honest. I'm just as human as you. Sometimes I want to tell you the truth just to get you away from me because you're annoying me. Now it's become about me. It hasn't become about you. And that means it's not about God's will. So there are times that I've had to apologize as well. I'm sorry. I did that because it was a selfish motive, and I apologize. And that's difficult to do as well. But when you start walking in the leadership of the Spirit, all of a sudden, you're not so much about vengeance. All of a sudden, you're not so much about the rights that I have in this world, because this world is a broken, terrible place. And that's why he calls us to live in this world and not as a part of this world. So when the Spirit leads, you're walking in faith. When the Spirit is not leading and you do it anyway, that's not walking in faith. It is, by definition, walking in sin. And what is that scripture I think Bob shared with me? Anything done outside of faith is, by the very definition, sin. Not about being right or wrong, not about trying harder, but about listening more. I don't want to ever have you hear me say, well, Dave told me that I shouldn't do that because that's bad. Let God tell you. Listen to his Spirit, and your life will adjust accordingly. If you truly want to do the will of God, that's exactly what you'll do. And you'll do it by the leadership of the Spirit. So, Pastor Bob, if you could come up, maybe that was a bad segue or a good one, but I don't think so. I think it worked right into it somehow, and God does that almost every week here.
Thank you, Dave. Oh, okay. It might be God. I wouldn't answer it anyway. Good morning. Another beautiful morning here. You know, God's so good to us. We have beautiful days here almost all the time. Once in a while, I think he wants us to have a little closer fellowship, and we end up huddling, and that always works out too. So it's God is good all the time. It's amazing just walking around this morning because I get ministered to just talking to some of you guys. I mean, I've already had conversations on forgiveness, on acceptance, on how many good things God's doing in our lives. And it just brings it home to me, because to realize that God's working in every life on this earth. Now, not everyone's receptive to it, and not everyone partakes of it, because he doesn't force himself. But when we're willing just to let go of our plans, and let go of our will, and let go of our trying to make things happen. So I find that to be very frustrating personally. I have to be honest. Don't we try to make things happen all the time? And when things don't go according to our plan, we get uptight. We get nervous. We double down. We try to, you know, finagle things even harder to make them come out the way we think that they should. I started working together with some people on this faith-based track that we're starting at the Recovery Center. And the way things worked out, the date's gotten pushed back a few weeks. Now, if I struggled with that, it wouldn't lead to any good. But I realized that, you know what, it's God's plan. It's not my plan. I just am blessed to get to be a little part of that plan. When we start to see that he has a bigger picture, that he has the whole view, that he has a master plan, then it starts to make sense that we really can't have it all figured out, and we really do need to walk by faith if we're going to be as foot soldiers, if you would. And he has this master plan, right? He's already won the battle. He's making things work out the way he wants, and we get to be part of that. But our part is really to love other people. Because like Dave said, when we start to get frustrated, when we start to get tense, it's usually because there's some ego involved. Freud would call it ego. The Bible calls it the flesh. And it's our own sin nature where we start to, you know, try to be our own little bosses instead of just letting God be God. And when we let God be God and just accept that timing is up to Him, our part, be available. So we're going to continue in the book of Acts, and I've kind of, in my mind, thought, you know, maybe I'll pick out a few highlights in here, and we'll just move right through and get to Romans, because, man, I can't wait to get to Romans. But the more I look, every time I open this up and look, God's like, slow your roll. He's got some stuff in Acts for us, I think. And today we're in chapter 17, preaching Christ at Thessalonica. Now when they had passed through, again my pronunciation, I learned to read by phonics, and it doesn't always work out when it comes to pronunciation that way, but you learn to read real good. Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. Then Paul, as his custom was, went into them, and for three Sabbaths reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and demonstrating that the Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead, and saying, this Jesus whom I preach to you is the Christ. He's showing the Jews who don't yet believe, they're still practicing the old law-based, old covenant religion, and he's showing them from the old covenant, because the New Testament hadn't been written yet, that Christ was there all along, that all of the Old Testament points the way to the coming of the Messiah. And he shows them how Christ in his earthly life fulfilled each of the Scriptures pertaining to him from the Old Testament. So he's reasoning with them. He's showing them, based on their own knowledge of the Scriptures, and they had good knowledge of the Scriptures, that look, this is what Scripture says, here's what Jesus did. Over here, this is what the Scripture says, here's what Jesus did. Again and again, Jesus fulfilled all those Old Testament prophecies about him because he is the Christ. And some of them were persuaded, and a great multitude of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women joined Paul and Silas. So out of the Jews and out of the Gentiles, believers are continuing to be added. Remember, we've read in previous chapters, believers being added daily. The Jesus movement, it's happening. It's in the early, early stages, the world goes, but it's happening at a rapid pace. But the Jews who were not persuaded became envious and took some of the evil men from the marketplace and gathering a mob. You can hear it happening. You know what? They were religious people. They don't like what's happening because it's offending their sensibilities and what they know, what they think they know. They are about their own power and their own ability to control the people, and they see that as the people are going over to Christ, that they're losing their influence. So what do? It says evil men in the marketplace. That happens today. Certain people don't want certain other people, right, to make progress, so they go get rabble-rousers, if you would, evil people out there, hired thugs, and they bring them in to harass the Christians and to harass the disciples. And listen to what they say. They go to Jason's house, they attack his house, and they can't find Paul and Silas, but when they didn't find them, they drag Jason and some brethren to the rulers of the city, crying out, "These who have turned the world upside down have come here too. Jason has harbored them, and these are all acting contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying there is another king, Jesus." Do you hear what they're doing? They don't have a legitimate scripture-based reason to cause this trouble, so they appeal to the Romans, saying, hey, they're breaking your laws. They're a threat to your ruler, who is like got his boot down on us. So they're using their enemy to attack their new perceived enemy, Christians. But I like that quote, what they said. Turn the world upside down. This is a revolution. This is a spiritual revolution of light coming into the world, and the darkness is recoiling in horror because it sees that it's losing. We don't realize what's going around us in the spiritual realm a lot of the time because we're so tuned into the daily physical stuff. We don't realize that when we're talking bad about somebody else, what's happening in the spiritual realm. Whose side are we on? Who, as Paul would say, who do we lend our members to? Who do we lend our ears to? Who do we lend our eyes to? Who do we lend our mouth to? We often have trouble recognizing because it's hard to be objective about ourselves. And I deal with this working as a therapist. The unconscious mind is so powerful that we'll, these defense mechanisms that are used, like denial, where we won't even go near what the real issue is in our own life because we don't want to touch that. We don't want that to come up. When Dave's right, sometimes we need to be stabbed in the front. Not to be used harshly, but carefully, with love. Sometimes we need to be confronted. Are we critical all the time? Are we stirring up trouble? Do we need to get some drama going over here so we can get the attention off us? Maybe we're doing it just to get out of our own mind, using it like a drug. Drama, dissension, troublemaking. You know anybody like that? I'm just saying. So they're getting them to stir the people up, and they drag them, you know, before the rulers. And it says they take security of Jason and the rest, and they let them go. Then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night. They're like, okay, you guys got to get out of here because it's you who they're really after. You're the real leaders, and we need to get you out of here. God is moving, see? They're not running away in fright, but as the Holy Spirit's leading them, they're going to go, and they're going to spread the word somewhere else. They've already established the movement in this case, in this place. And so they arrived at a synagogue of the Jews. They go straight back to work in a new place. And it says these were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. That's how exciting the good news is. That's how revolutionary it is. When I, listen, I grew up in Sunday school and church, but the first time I sat in a small home study group watching this video series called the Alpha Series, and I heard this John Glenn guy say things that were so foreign to what I had heard in church, because what I heard was Jesus is good and you need to go be good so that he'll save you. Now, they may not have said it in exactly those words, or maybe they did, but that was the idea. Oh, get saved, all your sins are gone, now you got to be good and don't, you know, let your record get spotted. See, Jesus will give you a clean record, but you better not mess it up. How does that work? It doesn't. And that's not the good news. The good news is our identity in Christ, that the new you that God made you to be is holy, righteous, and without blame. As Paul said in Romans, it's no longer I that sin, but sin living in me. Recognize the flesh for what it is, but that's not who we are anymore. When I heard these things, I had to go look them up, just like these early wannabe believers who became believers. They received it, but they're like, whoa, is this news that good? Let me go look it up. Look it up. That's what I did. And the more I started looking it up, the more it popped. And I was like, wow, the truth is that good. It's that attractive. So they're looking these things up daily because they're excited and they're enthused. Can you imagine living under law your whole life? The Ten Commandments, do this, don't do that, blessings or curses based on your performance. And now you're hearing that Jesus took all your sins away and paid for it for all time, and that he's made you holy and righteous without blame. It's hard to get our mind wrapped around that, and it still is today. So, I like this, though. It says, therefore, many of them believed, and also not a few of the Greeks, again, the Jews and the Gentiles. The good news is going out to everyone, prominent women as well as men. Just like it said back in verse 4. See, talk about equal rights. We're seeing God was equal rights to begin with. Let me tell you. Go back and read Genesis and see. We were made not to be identical, man and woman, not to be identical, but to complement each other, equal in the eyes of God. It's man that came up with this, try to subordinate everybody. That's a man-made thing, not a God thing. And here it is in the same chapter twice, pointed out, prominent women becoming believers because these women were influential in their families, in their homes, in the cities. Many of them went with the disciples and were out there taking part in the ministry. We get religious people get upset with that. Can't have women in ministry. Well, go back and read the book of Acts and see what the early church was up to. And it was a lot more egalitarian than what some people would think. So, Paul went to Athens, and his spirit was provoked, it says, when he saw that in Athens that there was so much idol worship going on. Everybody was given over to idols. There were statues everywhere. The god of this, the god of that, the god of this. And, of course, in any religion, you got to figure out, you know, what you're supposed to do. And he sees this, and it says in verse 18, then certain Epicurean and Stoic philosophers encountered him. Now he's come up against the intellectuals, academia, those that just spend all their time thinking lofty thoughts and thinking how much they know and how much there is to know and how much can we know, and posing all these questions and impressing themselves with the depths of their intelligence by the questions that they posed. So these come up against him, and he says, men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious. For as I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God. Now the Greeks were the advanced civilization, right, at that time. Greek culture was like the highest, you know, probably competed with the Roman culture, but the Romans got a lot of their ideas from the Greeks. And they had so many idols, and they had come to the conclusion that they couldn't figure out everything there was about all the gods that might exist, right? So they had created this statue to the unknown God to probably to cover all their bases. Kind of like some people today, right? Some people today actually, you know, always lead to God. So I'm going to try some of this. I'm going to try some of that. A friend of mine calls it the blender theology. I'm going to take a little bit that I like, you know, take a little Hindu, a little Buddhism, maybe a little bit from Islam, maybe a little bit from Christianity, some New Age stuff and some other things, and just mix it all up. And I'm going to be okay, because it's all good in the end. That's that blender theology. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the light. No man cometh to the Father but by me. God had a plan to redeem us, and his plan wasn't, you guys go figure it out, and you know, I'll let the cream rise to the top. Whoever comes up with the most intelligent-sounding way of redeeming themselves and tries the hardest, that's the one I'll let into heaven one day. That wasn't God's plan. He said, I have a plan. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. And what did he tell James and Peter and John on the mount? Hear him. Don't just listen to him. Hear him is what God said. Because he's the way. Jesus is the way. Now we can get into semantics, and we can say there's many roads that can get you to Jesus, and I'll agree with that because we all have personal stories. We all have the own journey that we've taken to get to the spot where we were broken and said, I can't do it, I need you. But at that point, to get to God is Jesus. And I love the way my friend Denny Ulrich said, because in my religiosity, I was a little worried about the AA stuff with, well, you know, okay, they're getting God as the higher power. What about Jesus? And Denny said, when God shows up, Jesus is right there with him. And I have found that, and I've seen that working in recovery. I've seen religious people try to shove Jesus at people, and it turns them off, and they don't like that. And I've also seen that when you present the truth with love and allow people to consider and don't try to make their decision for them, that the truth is attractive. And I've seen people that were totally turned off the religion come to Jesus. And you know what? They're still turned off the religion, and that's okay, because it's not about religion. It's about Jesus. That's what it's about. The worst thing you can do is to shove Jesus at somebody, get them saved, brother, and then put them under law and turn them into a religious zealot and send them out. And I'll tell you what, they're going to be relapsed before long, and they're going to be obnoxious in the process because they're trying to perform. And they're still just as dysfunctional. It's not the way God works. It's timing. You feel a calling on your life? Just yield to God. And maybe he'll start using you tomorrow or today or next week or next month or next year or down the road a bit. Often there's a period of time and period of preparation. Paul was out in the desert for years after he got saved, before he went and started ministering. God's timing. Who's going to be in charge? Am I going to be in charge, or is God going to be in charge? Well, I'll tell you what, it's a lot more peaceful when I let God be God. I also like what Paul said to these intellectuals, because they said, this is what they said about him. What does this babbler want to say? See, babbler. It's interesting that the Bible uses the word babbler, because if you go back to the Tower of Babel, man got so full of himself that he's going to build this tower to God, and they're all working on it, and they're like, watch us go, humanity, you know, humanism, it's all about us. And they're building this tower, and God changes all their languages, so they all speak different languages, and they can't understand each other, and they have to spread out into the world, as was God's plan. And here, babbler. See, it sounded like babbling to them, because for all their education, for all their intellectualism, they couldn't make sense out of what Paul was saying. It didn't make sense, because to earthly thinking, it didn't make sense. Their spiritual eyes weren't opened. Others said he seems to be a proclaimer of foreign gods, and they said this because he spoke about Jesus and the resurrection. And they said, we want to know what these things mean. For all the Athenians and the foreigners who were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear something new. So all these people that thought they knew so much, it says they spent their time in BSing, basically. That's what they spent their time doing. They wanted to hear something new. It's like people that got to turn on the TV to, you know, see which pop star got into trouble since last weekend. Or, you know, which lofty, high-up person out there has been brought down by some scandal. What does the Inquirer say about wanting to know? Wanting to know. So you want to know all this stuff, but it's useless stuff. Chatter. That's what it is. It's meaningless chatter. And this is what they were obsessed with. They had gone as far as they could go with learning anything as far as spirituality goes. But Paul's going to bring him the good news. And he says, therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing him, I proclaim to you, God who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth and does not dwell in temples built with human hands. Isn't it nice? We don't have to be in the sanctuary this morning worshiping. We're out here in the deck because you and I are the sanctuary. The Holy Spirit inhabits us. We're the sanctuary. Nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. God's always at hand. He's always right here. He's in us, within us. Jesus said the kingdom is within. We just need our eyes open to realize it. And the truth it comes down to, are we willing to believe it? Paul says, because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. Do you get that? God is going to judge the world. I'm no universalist. I'm not going to tell you that everybody's going to heaven no matter what. I'm going to tell you that everyone can go because God's judging the world by one capital M man, Jesus Christ. So it's by his righteousness. God looks at the world and he looks at Jesus' righteousness. You either have Jesus or you don't. If you have Jesus, it doesn't matter how many times you failed. It doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter how horrific the things you've thought, said, did. None of that matters. What matters is if you have Jesus, you have his righteousness. And if you don't have Jesus, I can tell you this. It's not about receiving him so that you can go do good things for God. It's so that you have Jesus, because he's the one that will do the good things through you. It's not in our strength as Christians that we walk. Please, no, don't think that. It's not in our strength. What did Paul say? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It's his strength that he gives us and works in us and through us. And I know the legalists, they throw in James. They always go back to that one verse, faith without works is dead. And that's true. But they put the cart before the horse. They say, well, I got to go do the good works so it shows I have faith. No, if you have faith, the good works will take care of themselves, because Jesus is the one working a good work in you and through you and in me and through me. It's Jesus doing it. That takes care of itself. The work of God, what is the work of God? They came and asked Jesus this, the Jews did, because they weren't getting what he was saying. They didn't understand about who Jesus was, and so he told them, this is the work of God. Believe on the one whom he has sent. Believe. That's what this is about. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, because Paul went on, he said, okay, by the man whom he has ordained, that's how God's going to judge the world. And God has given us this assurance because he resurrected his son. That's the proof. He was resurrected. God paid our sin debt through the death of his son, Jesus Christ. And in Christ's resurrection, we see the promise of eternal life in him. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, while others said, we will hear you again on this matter. You know, they want to go back and talk about it. And it's understandable. This was totally mind-blowing, and it didn't fit with their schema. It didn't fit with their paradigm or their little mental map of how things were. They spent all their time trying to figure out how things were, but this certainly didn't fit in it. This was as the Jews that got upset in Thessalonica said, this is turning the world upside down. And that's what happens when we encounter Jesus Christ. Our little world gets turned upside down. And what a beautiful way. What a beautiful way it gets turned upside down. Because it's no longer about us. It's no longer about me. God has changed so many of my plans in this past week. And you know what? I had a much better weekend as a result. What I thought I had planned, what I was going to do, all got changed around. Number of things completely changed around. And instead of worrying about it, when I finally just gave up and went with the flow, peace comes back. See, he's right there. He's right there. It's when we insist on taking the wheel that we get all tense and bound up. But when we let it go and let things happen as God handles them, they work out way better. And we don't have to have all that tension. So Paul departed from among them. However, some men joined him and believed. In the last verse, it mentions a woman named Damaris and others. The Bible's going out of its way, I think, in this chapter to show you that God doesn't put us on pedestals. He doesn't put men way up here, and then women is like a little afterthought down here. He doesn't do that. He's showing a level field. God loves each one of us and has just an important purpose for you today, whether you're a man or woman, young or old, or somewhere in between. It doesn't matter. God's got a plan. He had a plan from the beginning. We just didn't see it. We didn't see it through history. We didn't see it. A lot of us didn't see it in our own lives. Some of us had an inkling, but we went our own way. And there was a lot of stress and anxiety and worry and friction and frustration in our lives and our relationships because of that, because of going our own way, doing it my way, not being able to yield. I see that every day working in the addiction field as well. People with serious problems in their lives and yet struggle to give up their will in the simplest little things. Simplest little things. And a lot of people can be completely broken, or seemingly so, and temporarily yield. As soon as they start feeling a little better, and this is true of all of us, we start to feel a little better, things are going pretty well. Wow, look what God's doing. Wow, look what I'm doing. Wow, watch me go. And there we are again, back taking the wheel. It's a lifelong process for some of us. I'm a slow learner. I admit that. But when you finally learn it, when you finally start to get your head wrapped around it, you tend to yield it sooner rather than later, because it's like, oh yeah, I don't need to live with this tension, and give it back to God. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul talks about the reality of faith in Christ. He says, moreover, brothers, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and which you stand, by which you also are saved if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received. Paul saying, I'm teaching you the truth. I'm teaching you what I received. I'm not teaching you something I made up over here or thought up or daydreamed about. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again on the third day and according to the Scriptures, and he was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brothers at once, of whom the greater part remained to the present, meaning they were still alive when he wrote this, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles, then last of all, he was seen by me also as one born out of due time. Paul's world was was turned upside down. He was on the way, the same Paul, as you know from our earlier studies, to persecute, to whip, to flog, to stone, to imprison, to execute believers on that road to Damascus. And he encountered the living Christ. And his world was turned upside down so completely that he spent the rest of his life sharing the good news, starting churches, ministering these fledgling churches, feeding them the milk of the word, in the end, giving his life for his Savior.
All right. Great job. Thanks, Bob. So I pulled out of this a couple of slogans, a couple of two-word points that I think make a big difference. First thing is the master plan. The master has a plan. Are you on board with the master plan? And the other one that I kept hearing Bob say, and it just kept jumping out of his throat, was he has done things. He has made this happen. He has created. He has made a way. He has a plan. He has the answer. He has ordained. He has provided. And many other he has's that came out of that. I have to take that one out. There goes my head again. He has done it. So let's go through from top to bottom the list here. God has a plan to restore every person on earth that is willing to receive him. Are you willing to receive? Are you willing to accept this master's plan? I can't become righteous of my own. What we try to do on our own is that we try to grow and create fruits of the Spirit on our own. We try to find joy, and the best we get is happiness from happenings. We try to find peace, and the best we can do is find a peaceful spot or something that'll give us rest for a moment, but it's not eternal. We try to find patience, and we get frustrated in it. We try to do, I heard it put this way once, patience isn't waiting. Patience is what you do while you're waiting. So how do you wait? This one, this is me. Come on, let's go. Patience is what you do while you're waiting. Whatever. It's not meant to happen right now. But like Bob said, we want to work our own way. We want to force our plan into lives. And Bob mentioned these hired thugs. Somehow the word lobbyist came to my head. Go tell them how important we are and make sure it happens our way, and we'll make sure you're happy for a moment. I can't become righteous on my own. Jesus came and met all of the requirements for me on my behalf. He is the righteousness. He's the guy that we have to count on. Philosophy and religion will not save me. Bob mentioned the many paths, and I'm cautious about how I express this to people, but hey, there you are. How's it going, Kenny? You must have snuck in quietly this morning. He mentioned there are many paths to God. I believe this. God knows your hurts. God knows your needs. God knows what it's going to take for you to heal. And your journey in this life is going to be different than mine. I have different experiences. I have different memories in my flesh. I have different wounds than you. And he knows the right medicine. He does. Your journey with him is going to be different than mine is with him. Maybe you're a faster learner than I am. Maybe you're a slower learner. Like Bob said, I'm a slow learner. I admit it. You know, sometimes I'm stubborn. Sometimes I'm really bullheaded. Ask my wife. Sometimes I don't know when to shut my mouth. But when I get a hold of God's plan, all of a sudden I start to go, wait a minute, zip it. See, I've taken my own little thing here. When we say time out for the trip in, I had to adjust that for me. Zip the lip and take the trip. Find out what's going on in here. Shut up and pay attention to God for a minute. See, what we want in our lives is we want God's will to be done with what I'm doing. But we don't necessarily want to do God's will. And then we wonder why God's will doesn't get done. I'm going to go do what I want to do over here, and when it's blowing up, I'm going to go, I just want God's will to be done in this. When I created the havoc in the first place, and I'm not, again, saying right or wrong, but get aware of why things occur in your life. Well, I want God's will to be done, but I'm willing to lie, cheat, and steal over here and expect it to be different tomorrow. And it's not God punishing you. It's God allowing you to have a lesson. Get the lesson. That don't work. What if I seek God's will before I jump into my plan? What if God didn't ordain this particular motion today? It's not about me developing my perfect plan. God already has the perfect plan. He already has it. Bob taught me this one in jail a few years ago. Surrender is not nearly as pleasant as submit. Surrender is, I'm captured by the enemy, I got my hands in the air, I'm marching wherever they make me, and boy, I don't want to do it. And as soon as I get a chance to run, I'm out of here. Submit is, whatever you want to do, that's what I want to do. Let's do it. I will gladly follow without looking for an escape. I want what you want. I want the Father's will in my life. I want to do what He wants me to do. And the more you want to do what He wants you to do, the more you will do it. Because you'll find the reward is the fruits of the Spirit. You'll find joy, and you won't understand how. You'll find patience in the midst of horribly trying events, and you won't understand why. You'll find peace where it seems like the world is blowing up around you. That's God's way. And it's God's fruit, by the way. It ain't yours. Remember, God's the husbandman in the vineyard. God will take care of the things that aren't working for Him. He'll snip those branches off and let them fade away. The branches of you that are producing fruit for Him, He will tend to those so they create more fruit. Read the story. God's doing the work. He has a plan. He's doing the work. He sent His Son. He made a way. He has the answer. He is the path to peace, to righteousness, to glory, to patience, to love, to kindness. Maybe we ought to put it this way. Jesus was our lobbyist. Jesus went to the master and said, Lord, this one's mine. Do it our way for him. Lead him, just like it comes out of the Lord's Prayer. I had a request by Doug. He's getting ready to go on a spiritual renewal weekend called Via de Cristo. And he's going to be there next weekend, right? So he asked about doing the Lord's Prayer. And before we're done, I want to. But I want to look at it real quick. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, thy kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. Give us today everything that we need, our daily bread. Forgive us when we make mistakes, when we trespass, and forgive those that trespass against us as well. That one jumped out just now. Pray for your enemies. See, we're all about praying for our troops and praying for our country and our side. Pray for your enemies. Maybe they need the love of God too. Lead us not into temptation. My gosh, why would he ever? That's not the path of righteousness. Deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory. You are the answer. Help us to see your will, your way, and give us the weakness to go with you, because it's not in our strength. Bob mentioned that. It's not in our strength that he does things. It's in our weakness that God will be strong. I can't do this, God. I need you. It's not about doing enough good things. It's about Jesus. It's about being led of the Spirit. He said, faith without works is dead, and I hear that an awful lot. But you know what is just as horrible? Works without faith. You're killing yourself for no apparent reason because it's not earning you anything. You can work real hard for your righteousness, but you'll never be perfect. I tried. I tried, and it wore me out, and it'll wear you out. But that's good news, too, believe it or not, because when you're worn out and you finally give in. Say, okay, God, I get it. You're perfect. I'm not. Show me. Show me your way. My judgment will be based on the righteousness of Christ. Is he there? Is he not there? Do I have it? Do I not have it? When I stand at the gate, if the questions pose, why should we let you in? Only one reason. Because of Jesus Christ, my righteousness. I got a free ticket. Thank you. No condemnation, no judgment. Doesn't give you the license to do whatever the heck you want, but you know what? You can do whatever the heck you want, but you will have the consequences. Get the lesson. Jesus is the one and only way to a relationship with God. I used to call Jesus, he's like AT&T, you know, because that's our communication system with God. And then I realized that was flawed because we have to pay for that service. Well, okay. It's bigger than AT&T too because we don't just get to hear his voice, we get to see him. So then this wonderful new creation came out, Skype. It's free and you can see him and you can hear him. Jesus is like Skype. If it wasn't for him coming, we wouldn't have that communication line with God. But because he came, we can accept his Spirit in our heart, and we have the link up. You're linked up to the answer. And if you're not linked up to the answer, here's a little challenge for you. Link up to the answer. My uncle's response was, I can't do it. And my response to him was, no, you won't do it. Because you're too stubborn. And I believe in the end, I believe when he took his last breath, if I know my cousin's words, and I do believe that they were correct, he struggled right to the end with his faith. No, 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 I'm not ready. He was struggling right to the very last breath. And my cousin Karen said, and then he stopped, and she said, I saw this sense of peace come over him. He exhaled and went, okay, I'm ready. And he went. I believe that he finally accepted the faith that he never would accept in that 11th hour. Maybe that's just a comfort for me, but I wasn't there. I know it's a comfort for his daughter, my cousin. And I believe that God is that good that he's not going to let you. You can fight him all of your life if you choose to. You can deny him all of your life if you choose to. But I believe that one day you might have that one shot where you'll look in the eyes of Jesus and say, wow, I was wrong. Okay, I'll take it. And you'll be miserable right up until that point. Or you'll pretend you're not. How about that one? Because I did a lot of pretending I wasn't miserable too. Take the time out for the trip in for a minute. Oh, by the way, if I have received Jesus, paid in full. Anything I've done wrong, it's covered. Anything I'm going to do wrong, and I still will, and so will you, it's covered. There's no condemnation. It's covered. God knew we were flawed. He created us. We don't have to tell him. He don't have to tell us we're flawed. We know we're flawed. You don't have to tell somebody they're messing up. They know. And in spite of all that, he loves us. He sent his son, and he said, I know you're flawed. It's okay. I love you. I will make a way for you to be back with me. What does he want to restore us to? You know what? My picture is this. They walked in the cool of the evening with their father. They were naked and unashamed. They had not just physically naked, spiritually naked, personally naked. They had an awesome, open, translucent relationship with God where they knew everything about him, he knew everything about us, and everything was good. That's what he wants to restore you to. God's love is that way. And he wants you to know it. So, time out for the trip in. Or how about this one? If I zip my lip, I won't be able to take the trip, but I'm going to help you take your trip. Quit chattering. Quit babbling. Quit trying to pretend you know all the answers because you don't. Am I working really hard to prove that I'm righteous? Or do I just do what God tells me to do? And sometimes it sounds like a cop-out. But you know what? A lot of times when you're working really hard, there's a lot of people who will take advantage of you. I met a lady who worked most of her life in ministries. And all the ministries, all the good big names that she worked for, never took the time to know that her faith was not intact. And it agitated me to no end. They used her and used her and used her and used her because she was cheap labor. And when it came time for her to come to the end, she was scared to death. She had no faith. But yet she could check off this list of who I worked for. I did 9 years with this ministry. I did 12 years with that ministry. I said, wow. And you're scared to death because you don't know what's going to happen when you close your eyes. And none of those ministries reached out to help you. That made me furious. Made me furious. Trust God's leading. Am I planning my work and working my plan? You remember that one? I don't know. Who was it? Zig Ziglar or one of them. Plan your work and work your plan. Hey, it's great to have a goal, but you know what? Plan to do his work and work on his plan. Might be better. Or am I being led of God in my righteousness? Do I know that I am completely accepted and loved just as I am? Do you know that yet? Do you know that you are totally and completely loved by God? He accepts you right like you are. I don't care what your flaw is. It's not unforgivable. You're not unforgivable. You're not unlovable, and you're not unacceptable. And that's difficult for a lot of people who have heard all their lives. They're no good. They're this. They're that. Throw those lying voices away and seek the voice of God. When God shows up, Jesus is right there with him because they're one and the same. Good news. And I'm sorry, but my brain goes to rock and roll. You guys know me enough at this point. But he said, who do we lend our ears to? Who do we lend our minds to? Who do we lend our hearts to? And my head went right to George Thorogood. Who do you love? Who do you love? Really? Is it you? Is it God? Is it your job? Is it your money? Is it your stuff? Who do you love? And that'll give you an answer maybe to as to who your God is. So let's close our eyes in prayer. I'm going to turn our world upside down a little bit. Doug and Kat are going to be up here in this corner just for a change doing communion. But we're going to close in prayer, and then I would love you to all just kind of join us in a cappella singing of the Lord's Prayer. If you know it, I'll lead it. Follow along. If you feel like you want to hold hands with your neighbor and let God lead in that, I'm not forcing you to. If you feel like you want to close your eyes, do it. If you feel like you want to open your eyes, do it. If you feel like weeping, do it. If you feel like not singing, do it. Do what God tells you to do, not us. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you today for your leading spirit. We thank you for the gospel, the good news, that your love is present, that you are enough, you have the plan. Father, we thank you that you laid your spirit within us, that we can hear and see God because of our connection through the Spirit. Lord, give us the weakness to give you our strength. Give us the weakness to hand you the reins. Give us the boldness to trust you when things are difficult, and the boldness to speak what you would have us to speak in love. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And before Tammy sings her song, we're going to sing Our Father, which art in heaven. And we'll just do it a cappella. This is sending Doug off for next weekend. And Doug, I want to pray for you in the name of the Father right now that no matter who is in control in that weekend as a man, that you would be led of God and that his will be done through you and you would be a shining light there like I know you always are. That's why he keeps getting asked back. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, that God will be done through Doug and through every other person who's led of your spirit, that they'd have the boldness to say, this is the truth. God, help them to love it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day.
God bless you. All right, Miss Tammy, this one's on you.
You live in me.
Today. Everybody.
All right.
Oh, let's do it again.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things. Above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began.
It's Russ was just reminding me, everybody keeps asking us when therapy is going to play again. Therapy is going to play here Thursday on St. Paddy's Day from 1 to 4:30. No, we don't know any Irish music, but come on out and instead of kissing the Blarney Stone, you can enjoy some rock. So Thursday, 1 to 4:30 here. We're going to call it St. Paddy McGee's Day because she's been a saint to us. Y'all drive safe. Be careful out there. I hope you can sing this song yourself and mean it, because this is important.
Every move I'm making you, you make me move. Jesus, every breath I take, I breathe in you. Every step I take in you, you are my way. Jesus, every breath I take, I breathe in you.
we're going out on a rocker. I'm just giving you fair warning. If you like Brian Adams, hang around. If you don't, here it comes anyway. His love so strong that he gave his life for you and I. Oh, and he loves me so. Used to hurt so bad because I didn't know. But when my life gets rough, I need to feel in your touch. I'm gonna run to you. Sunday, share the love, not the hate. Share the faith, not the religion. God bless you.